One of the types of experiments we want to do is to vary what's called the effusion rate. That is, vary the volume of lava that we're pouring out per unit time, basically the rate that we pour the lava. And this is important because it controls the way the lava behaves as it flows down the slope. As we're going to see in our experiments, one of the important factors that controls the behavior of the lava flows and the ultimate shape of a lava flow is the development of the crust on its outer surface. The faster the lava flows down the slope, the less chance the crust has to form. It's sort of a race between the lava moving down the slope and the growth of the crust that's trying to stop it from moving. So we're gonna try a lava pour here where we've got the temperature up at about 1100 degrees C, and we're gonna try to pour it as fast as we can to get a really fast pour. And this will contrast with some of the slower pours that we've done in the past. We're getting ready to do another experiment here. We're gonna do two pours here in rapid succession. The first one we're gonna pour as rapidly as we can while the lava is very hot on the right-hand side. This is a 12 degree slope and we'll get the temperature of the lava. It's probably gonna be about 1100 degrees when it hits the sand. And then we'll back it off and do a slower pour on the other side, and hopefully we'll be able to see a contrast in the shape of the lava flow and the behavior of the lava as it moves down slope. This is very hot fluid lava. It's moving very rapidly, spreading out. You can see it moving down past our 10 centimeter divided scale. It's very, very hot, probably hotter than most lavas are when they flow out. So we got a really nice rapidly moving flow. We'll be able to get a very good estimate of the viscosity of the lava flow. One of the things we're doing in our experiments here is not just trying to understand the viscosity of the liquid. That's something that's relatively easy to measure and something that we can determine in various ways. But one of the things that is harder to determine but of more practical interest to us is the viscosity of the whole lava flow system that embodies the lava, the liquid lava, bubbles, crystals that are still in the lava, and of course the crust that's forming. And you can see as our lava flow creeps its way down slope, it's coolest down at the end. You can see it's getting darker colored, and you can see that it's arresting the downslope movement. So it's getting hard to push the lava flow down as that crust gets stronger and stronger down at the toe of the lava flow and arrests the downslope movement. The lava's up above, farther back up in the flow, is still moving downslope. It's still pushing down inside there, and sometimes this leads to breakouts or little lobes that form down on the toe of the lava flow. As the lava continues to flow, it develops those beautiful folds on the surface. It's the same pattern of ripples that form on, for example, glaciers, where viscous material is also moving downslope under the influence of gravity. So this one's just about done now. It's probably cooled down to at least 800 degrees. Next, we're going to do another pour here. And Allison's ready to divert the lava down the other channel. And we're going to pour this at a slower rate. The lava's, it'll be slightly cooler because it's been sitting without the burners on for a few moments here. It's going to come down the near channel, and we'll have a little flow coming down this direction where we let the lava flow much slower. Lava's still very fluid and hot. Our trough is heated up from the previous flow now, so it should move pretty smoothly now. NOAA's controlling the flow and keeping the flow very slow this time compared to the last one. So it creeps slowly down through our channel. You can see beautiful folds are forming also in the skin as it develops, coming down our nice semicircular channel that we use for a tube there. That's actually, even within that little area there, we can make nice measurements of the viscosity. Okay, now the lava's moving out onto the sand. It's cooled down a bit. It's probably around 1,000 degrees C or so. And you can see lumps of crust that are embedded in the lava flow and are being rafted down slope. They're traveling right along. A complicated pattern of flows and folds are forming. as they initially form sort of at a high angle to the direction the lava is forming. They then rotate and kind of get pushed to the side, kind of building a levee of cooled crust material that's all rippled and darker colored in this lava flow. The light's just right here, so you can see some complicated sort of folds and ripples and distortions of the surface that take place. If you look back at where the lava's pouring out, you see NOAA's pouring it out in just a thin stream now. And so the effusion rate is much, much slower than in that first lava flow. And I think you can see that it's flowing at a much slower rate and that the crust has already developed, even though it's only about a meter down the slope from the end of the trough. A nice dark, probably 800, 850 degree crust has formed, and it's slowing down the downslope progress of the lava flow. It's still flowing inside. I think you can see when you look up by the end of the trough, you still see lava flowing down inside the insulating skin that's produced by that overlying crust. If that is allowed to drain out, it leaves behind a hollow lava tube, and we see that in many of our experiments here. So there's two lava flows side by side, one poured out very rapidly and the other one more slowly, and you can see how the crust strongly controlled the length of the lava flow and the rate at which it flowed. As that crust is very important for us to understand its behavior, its physical properties, and how it changes the way lava moves and the way a lava flow looks in the end. As geologists, of course, we would like to go in the field and look at the final shape of a lava flow that we haven't seen actually when it was active, and be able to work backwards to say something about how rapid the flow rate was, its temperature, the slope, and all of those types of parameters. Okay, looks like it's pretty much done here, and it's another opportunity to see the interesting properties of the lava at our right up at the tip. You see Bob's going to pull that off, and that gooey taffy-like lava, he has to sort of twist it off there. It very rapidly becomes brittle, and he'll be able to bang his tongs and it'll just break off. But not while it's hot like that, not while it's over 1,000 degrees C. It remains very, very plastic, and it can flow. So you can get a feeling for how strong that lava flow was. It's the sort of enveloping crust was as it started to move downslope. In the next session, we're going to move on to yet another complication where we look at what happens when we pour the lava over different materials. So far, all our experiments have been basically on dry sand, and we're going to see that that subsurface material makes a difference when we start pouring lava over different materials.